Jump suspects he's Coda.
He'd better.
Your pulse is 242. Your blood pressure is practically non-existent. Assuming you call that green stuff in your veins blood.
The readings are perfectly normal for me, Doctor. Thank you.
Ich wengi. Komi.
Winga chlami buffik savikam.
Being Vulcan means following disciplines and philosophies that are difficult and demanding of both mind and body.
Yes, Father.
You constantly display your emotions. You have even been seen fighting in the street.
Yes, Father.
The time draws near when you will have to decide whether you will follow Vulcan or human philosophy. Vulcan offers much. No war, no crime. Order, logic, and control in place of raw emotions and instinct. Once on the path you choose, you cannot turn back.
Yes, Father.
When I suggested to Spock that it was time for his routine checkup, your logical, unemotional first officer turned to me and said, "You will cease to pry into my personal matters, Doctor, or I shall certainly break your neck."
Spock said that?
What is this? If I want anything from you, I'll ask for it.
Which nature is Spock's true nature? What exactly is being suppressed? Like Othello's hail fellow well-met energy, Spock's placid, reflective demeanor is a silk bow tied around a grenade.
Spock, it is I.
You bring, parted from me, and never parted. Never and always touching and touched. We meet at the appointed place.
The contradictions keep roiling beneath. And in the classic episode, A Mock Time, which shows Spock's home planet and discloses Vulcan culture's unexpectedly savage pon-farr mating ritual, and in the numerous episodes in which mysterious ailments or puppet master aliens flush the Trek character's hidden aspects out into the open, we see that Mr. Spock is, in fact, more human than he would like to admit.
Mr. Spock.
What is it, Nurse?
Mr. Spock. Men from Vulcan treat their women strangely. At least, people say that.
But you're part human, too. I know you don't. You couldn't hurt me, would you? I'm in love with you, Mr. Spock. You, the human Mr. Spock, the Vulcan Mr. Spock.
Nurse, you should...
Christine, please. I see things, how honest you are. I know how you feel. You hide it. But you do have feeling. Oh, how we must hurt you, torture you.
I'm in control of my emotions.
The others believe that. I don't. No, I love you. I don't know why, but I love you. I do love you. Just as you are. Oh, I love you.
Sorry.
Captain is en route engineering, Mr. Spock. Can you take the bridge? Acknowledge.
I am sorry.
Christine.
Christine.
Bridge to sick bay. Is Mr. Spock there?
It's in Mr. Spock's relationship with Nurse Chapel, a deep crush expressed and then suppressed, that we see Spock at his most tortured and vulnerable. His anguish at the thought of acting on his impulse is overwhelming. Its mix of desire and disgust is Oedipal. It is this urge towards miscegenation that overtook Spock's own father and gave birth to Starfleet's finest officer.
Chapel.
Yes, Mr. Spock.
I had a most startling dream. You were trying to tell me something, but I couldn't hear you. Be illogical for us to protest against our natures. Don't you think?
I don't understand.
Your face is wet.
I came to tell you that we are bound for Vulcan. We'll be there in just a few days. My name is Christine.
Yes, I know, Christine. Would you make me some of that lo-mix soup?
Oh, I'd be very glad to do that, Mr. Spock.
Once on the path you choose, you cannot turn back.
The central irony of Spock's predicament is that his father's admonition to choose one path over another amounts to a false and damaging description of how personality is constructed.
I mean, Doctor, that we are faced with a staggering contradiction.
People are not and never can be either or, either aggressive or peaceful, loving or cold, petty or kind, passionate or logical. A multitude of selves coexist within each soul, and Spock is no exception.
Do you understand?
Not really, but it doesn't matter. I love you anyway.
Surely a character plagued by this many demons deserves to be labeled unhappy. Yet to apply that label to Spock would be most illogical. While one can never say he's at peace with himself, one can say he's at peace with the fact that he's not at peace. Though he never says it in so many words, it seems possible that Spock knows, or feels, that his soul contains multitudes. Warrior, scientist, lover, son, and most of all, Starfleet officer. This last role is by far the most satisfying for Spock because, as they say on Earth, in the military, you don't salute the man, but the uniform. This interpretation is validated by a fleeting but vivid and brilliant bit of stagecraft by Nimoy in the climax of Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, in which Spock, on his last legs after repairing a radiation leak that threatened to destroy his beloved Enterprise, hauls himself to his feet, then absentmindedly straightens the hem of his coat. It's his nonverbal way of honoring ideals and aspirations worth dying for. He's too human to be Vulcan, too Vulcan to be human. But in uniform, he's simply Spock.
The needs of the many outweigh
the needs of the few.
Or the one.
I'll see you on the bridge, Admiral. Company, dismissed.
Where is love? Does it fall from skies above? Is it underneath the willow tree that I've been dreaming of? Where is she? Who I close my eyes to see? Will I ever know the sweet hello that's meant for only me? Who can say where she may hide? Must I travel far and wide till I am beside the someone who
my work is done here.
What do you mean your work is done? You didn't do anything.
Didn't I?